In this video, we're going to make a very simple radio transmitter. And this radio transmitter is going to be one that's very easy to understand. In the slide that I'm going to show right now, I've got one of the Maxwell's equations. If you've never had a class in electromagnetics or electromagnetic theory before, then don't worry about it. But if you have had a class in electromagnetics before, or you've heard of Maxwell's equations, then this one particular equation will explain how radio transmitters work. It's the only Maxwell's equation that we have in the entire class. This equation holds for every point in space. H is the magnetic field, J is the current density flowing through a wire, for example, and E represents the electric field at that point in space. I want to describe three different situations. The first situation is when you have a constant flow of current through a wire. In this situation, you will generate a constant magnetic field, but because of the time derivative in the equation, you're not going to generate an electric field along with it. When you were a child, if you've ever taken a piece of copper wire and wrapped it around a nail or another ferromagnet, you know that you can create an electromagnet, but you're not going to generate a radio wave. The second situation I'd like to describe is where you have a time-dependent magnetic field. You could do this quite simply by shaking a magnet. And if you shake a magnet near a wire, you're going to induce a time-dependent current flow in that wire. This is exactly how a generator works in an electrical power plant. But along with the time-dependent current, you're also going to generate a time-dependent electric field. The third situation I'd like to describe, and that which is most important for this class, is the case where you have a current that's time-dependent. If you have a current that's not constant with respect to time, you're going to generate time-dependent electric and magnetic fields. In other words, an electromagnetic wave. So this is how we can make radio waves. All we need to do is make a current that changes with respect to time. In other words, a current flow can't be constant. So what I have here on the left is a simple radio transmitter, and what I have here on the right is a simple radio receiver. We could imagine a sine wave generator hooked up to a wire with an antenna at the top and an earth ground at the bottom. What's nice about a sine wave is that if you have a sine wave, then the current is not going to be constant. If you have a constant current, you get a constant magnetic field, but no radiation. Let me start an animation here just to show in a cartoon type of fashion how an electromagnetic field could be generated. So if we have a wire and we jiggle the electrons up and down, then the electric field is also jiggling. The current is not constant. So as that electromagnetic wave expands throughout space, it could intersect another wire, for example, and cause the electrons in the other wire to start varying up and down as well. So you can induce a time-dependent current flow in another wire somewhere else in space. And this is how radios work. If you still have trouble understanding how electromagnetic fields work, you can think of an everyday example, and that's a magnet. Imagine that you have a kitchen magnet or a bar magnet in one hand and you have a magnet in the other hand, and they're not very far apart. If you have the north poles together, then you know that the north poles oppose. If you take one magnet and you kind of jiggle it in one hand, you can feel the other magnet kind of jiggling back and forth just a little bit, even if they're not touching one another. That's because you've generated a radio wave. And if you have a bar magnet and you shake it back and forth at 1 hertz and you can feel that 1 hertz vibration in a magnet that you're holding with your other hand, then you've created a 1 hertz radio wave. It's just that you've not transmitted very far. All right, now I'm going to actually build a very simple radio transmitter. It's going to generate a signal that we can actually hear in the radio. So I'm going to go ahead and turn on this radio, and it's an AM radio. And I've got it set here to 1500 kilohertz, 1.5 megahertz. I'm going to turn up the volume so that my microphone picks it up. And my simple radio transmitter is in fact really simple. It's a 9-volt battery with a wire. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this end of the wire, I'm going to start tapping it to one of the terminals of the battery. And as I tap it, we should be able to hear something in the radio. Let's see if it works. I think it works quite well. It's a radio transmitter because these aren't touching and I can hear it in the radio. Let's see how the range is. I'm going to slowly move it apart. It's got a terrible range, about 30 centimeters, right? I want to demonstrate two more things. One is that you hear a pop in the radio, not only when I make the connection, but also when I break the connection. So let me do this experiment. Listen carefully. You see, we heard two pops, not just one. So that's important, and I'll explain why here in a moment. Something else that I want to demonstrate is that this works at other frequencies. So I've now tuned the radio to 1 megahertz. Let's see if it still works. It still works, but I don't have as good a range at 1 megahertz for some reason. There's a lot more radio noise at 1 megahertz. Now I would like to demonstrate what happens if we increase the voltage of the radio transmitter. So I've got a 9-volt battery here. Let's replace the 9-volt battery with something bigger. I've got a whole box full of other 9-volt batteries. I like 9-volt batteries because they're easy to fit together. All right, now I have 10 batteries in total, and I've tuned the radio back to 1.5 megahertz, so the frequency is the same as it was the last time we checked the range with one battery and had the best result. So I'm going to repeat the experiment by tapping the whole set, 90 volts. All right, what I can conclude from the experiment that I just carried out is that the voltage does not give us a significant improvement on the range. Let's now take a look at an explanation for some of the phenomena that we just witnessed on the radio. Now, first of all, we only heard pops in the radio. We didn't hear any other kind of sound. Why did we just hear pops? And furthermore, why did we hear a pop when I both closed the connection and opened the connection? Let's take a look at the circuit diagram. It's just a battery in series with a switch. Now, initially, the electrons are not moving at all. The current is zero. There's no radio wave released. When the switch is closed, then electrons have to increase their velocity from zero up to their terminal velocity as they move through the wire. Once the switch stays closed long enough, there will eventually be a constant flow through the wire because the wire has a finite resistance and the battery has a finite amount of current that it can output. The electrons are only accelerating for a short period of time as they accelerate from zero up to that terminal velocity. It happens so fast that we interpret it in our ears as a pop. Once the switch is closed and the current flow is constant, then we no longer have an electromagnetic wave. When the switch is opened, the process happens in reverse. The electrons have to decelerate and return their velocity to zero. And it takes time for that to happen. It happens quickly, and that's why we hear a pop. So we hear two pops, once when we close the switch and once when we open the switch. Now, the second thing that we noticed when we did the demonstration is that it worked no matter where I had the dial turned. We tried it at 1.5 megahertz and we tried it at 1 megahertz. The reason why it worked at both of the frequencies is because the Fourier transform of a delta function is a line in frequency space. If we look at the boxed equation on the right, I've got a delta function plotted with respect to time at the top and its Fourier transform plotted at the bottom, and you can see the relationship between the two. When we release a pulse of power in the form of electromagnetic radiation, then it covers all of the frequency space, and that's why we could hear these pops no matter where I tuned the dial. On the other hand, if I could somehow channel all of the power into a single sine wave, then the Fourier transform would have just been a vertical line. And had I turned the dial then to some other radio station that doesn't have the same frequency, then I would not have been able to hear anything. And this is a lot more efficient use of power. So going forward, we need to start to look at how we can synthesize a sine wave. If we can synthesize a sine wave electronically, then we can channel all of our power into that one particular radio station. It'll be a lot more efficient use of the power. But before we do that, in the next video, we can make some other improvements to our very simple radio transmitter. Another problem with the radio transmitter, in addition to its poor range and the fact that it sends its power across the whole radio spectrum, is the fact that it's very wasteful of energy, very wasteful of power. Because as soon as I make the connection, then we're really draining the battery. We need to find some way to stop that from occurring, and that's what we'll look at in the next video.